Well, good afternoon, everyone. This is Michael Gutter from the University of Florida. And if you're on this, if you're hearing my voice, then you are joining us for the web conference entitled How to Use and Evaluate Social Media in Financial Education. I know so many of us nowadays right now are being pulled in this direction to utilize social media and try and work with Facebook and Twitter and so many other cool little things that are out there. And some of us have different levels of experience and comfort zones with this. And then even when we're using it, we're trying to figure out how do we know how effective it's been. Well, fortunately, today we're joined by three of our leading gurus in Extension to work with us and talk with us a little bit more specifically about how we can utilize social media in our financial education efforts, and then very importantly, how to evaluate that. If you would, please, I'd like to just take a moment and introduce our specialists, our panelists. And first, we have Dr. Barbara O'Neill, an Extension specialist in family resource management for Rutgers Cooperative Extension. I think many of you know Barb. She's written well over 1,500 newspaper articles, 130 articles for professional publications. She holds the CFP designation as well, and is the author or co-author of 8 separate books. So we're certainly pleased to have Barb with us today. Some of you may have noticed also that Andrew Zumwalt was listed as one of our presenters. I wanted to just mention briefly that Andrew is kind of one of our technical gurus in many instances on all things social media, so we listed him as one of our experts. But our second and third presenters will actually be Michael Ravenscraft, financial education specialist with the University of Missouri Extension. Michael works with financial planning, providing financial planning knowledge to individuals and families and communities throughout Missouri, and has a background of a Master of Accountancy from Truman State University in Kirksville, Missouri. He's a CPA and a certified financial planner and serves as the co-chair of the social media for the Financial Security Offer Community of Practice. And our final presenter will be Dr. Ann Adrian, the social media strategist with eExtension and the Military Families Partnership. And she's located at Auburn University. For most of her career, Dr. Adrian has concentrated on finding, evaluating, and explaining concepts around technology use. Since 2007, she focused on social media and its benefits and tips for using social media for extension and education. Today, we'll spend a brief part of our the earliest part of our conversation. Dr. O'Neill will talk a little bit about using Twitter, some of the basic mechanics, and hopefully learn a little bit more about that process. We'll then segue into Michael Ravenscraft, who will talk with us a little bit about using Facebook in financial education. And then finally, we'll end with Dr. Adrian from Auburn on social media impact evaluation. So we look forward to hearing from all of our presenters today. As always, if you have questions as they're coming up, the best way to do that is to type those questions into the chat window. I'll do my best to make sure those questions are fielded by our experts in a timely manner, but that will be the easiest way to make that happen. And again, at the end, as always, there'll be some brief polls asking you for some feedback about the web conference. We hope you'll take the time to answer those. But I'm really excited, and it's my distinct pleasure to turn this conversation over now to our panelists. So, Dr. O'Neill, let's...
Well, and thank you to everyone who's logged on to our webinar today. We hope to give you a lot of information and skills that you can use to practice some of these social media strategies yourself, and also to get involved in some of the projects that are coming down the pike through our COP. So I'm going to start out with just talking a little bit about Twitter. And before I do that, though, I wanted to share with you the results of part of our survey that we did. The Financial Security for All COP sent out a survey right before the holidays. We wanted to get a better handle on what people were doing with social media and how they were doing it. And so this slide here kind of summarizes the frequency with which various types of social media are being used by COP members. And you can see in the red that hands down Facebook is being used a whole lot more frequently than any other type of social media at this point. And then the other thing that we did find is that primarily our COP members are using social media via computer, and not so much with a smartphone, although 36% are using a smartphone, but primarily people are sending their messages through a computer of some sort. So that's kind of interesting as background. Why use social media? Many of you have probably heard the statistic. It's been promoted pretty heavily the last year or so that if Facebook were a country, it would be the third largest in the world after India and China. And there are more Facebook users than people that certainly live in the United States. And if you look at YouTube, it's the second most popular search engine after Google. And if you look at Twitter, Twitter has been growing faster than any other social network as far as picking up people who are users. Now, I will say with that data from Twitter that it's very concentrated. There's a whole lot of people that have established Twitter accounts that don't do anything with it, and then a much smaller number of users who are tweeting on a regular basis. But still, the numbers are there, and it's very clear as extension educators, financial educators, that's where we want to be. We want to be where the people are. Okay, so I did this presentation at AFCPE. We had a little bit more time at that workshop, and I actually had people write a mission statement in the workshop. We're not going to do that today, obviously, in the interest of time, but I encourage you to think about doing that before you actually get actively involved with Twitter. Decide early on, do you want to have an account just for professional use? Do you want to do some tweeting about your personal life as well as your professional life? Or would you prefer to have two separate accounts, a personal Twitter account and a professional Twitter account? You can do any of these, but it just makes a whole lot of sense to know what you're doing early on. And then if you have other types of social media, you can decide if you want to link back and forth. And Michael's going to talk about that with Facebook. So I encourage you to think about that. And I provided my Twitter mission statement just to give you an example of what you might do. So mine is to provide useful research-based personal finance information and occasional non-controversial personal anecdotes to an increasing number of followers. So I'm not going to get into politics. I'm not getting into any kind of controversial subject. It's basically personal finance, and then maybe every once in a while I'll send something out about Rutgers or something. But again, my focus is on research-based financial information. Now, how do you tweet? Well, you set up an account, and a little bit later, we're going to pop up a homework assignment that will tell you step-by-step, for those of you that aren't tweeting yet, how you can get involved with using Twitter. So you basically just go to twitter.com and you'll register with a username and a password, and then you're really good to go. And then all you need to do with Twitter is to put your message in that little box that says what's happening. And you'll notice that it says 140, and the reason for that is because you have 140 characters, and it will count down for you as you begin to type in the space. So there's your 140 characters, and if you look at the slide there, you can see that tweets are short. They've been referred to as microblogging because it's kind of like a blog, but it's a very shortened blog. You have 140 characters, and you can see from the screenshot there that most people, when they tweet, will put in some kind of link. So even though you might be limited in the tweet to 140 characters, your link could be to a website, it could be to a fact sheet, it could be to anything that's got a whole lot more content than the tweet itself actually has. So you can see some examples there. You can see that there's a picture, my picture on the bottom, and then some logos in some of the earlier tweets that kind of go along with the message itself. Another thing you want to do when you go on Twitter is you can complete a profile. And it's important, particularly if you choose a Twitter name as I did. I chose MoneyTalk1, where my Twitter name isn't my personal name. So it's important to make sure that people know who the person is behind the Twitter username. So you can see in the upper corner there on the right that it has my full name. It has my location in New Brunswick, New Jersey, where Rutgers is, our website. And then a very short bio. I believe you get 160 characters to put into your profile for your bio. So again, you have to kind of be concise, but you want to tell the world who you are because that establishes your credibility as an information source on Twitter. Okay, then the question becomes, what do you tweet about? And I don't know about you, but any of you that are on Twitter, you kind of run through your stuff, your personal stuff that you've written pretty quickly, you know, things that you might have on your university website for extension. So you'll have to always be on the lookout for interesting content for your followers. So obviously we can tweet to our fact sheets and our newsletters and our press releases for various events in Cooperative Extension. Any news articles where you're quoted, for example, a local newspaper calls you and their article is on the web, you probably want to do those pretty quickly because a lot of those articles don't stay up on newspaper websites too long. Any kind of interesting articles that you read, Facebook pages, any reputable sources of information like the Wall Street Journal, or perhaps you have a blog. For example, Patty Wooten Swanson in California has just set up a Small Steps to Health and Wealth blog. So I've been putting a link or two into that occasionally because people can see how she's doing with her challenge there for Small Steps. Or perhaps you have some YouTube videos, like the folks in Florida have done some great YouTube videos with youth. Or maybe some music. You can put links into those. Or even just tweet about a very short concept, things that we teach about all the time, like pay yourself first. And then the other thing that you could do is you can retweet messages that you've received from people that you're following. You think they're valuable messages, and you want to pass them along to your followers, which is a process called retweeting. So when you're working with Twitter, these are really the three things that you want to do. You want to try to build a network, you know, have people that are following you. You want to engage with your followers and keep them interested and make sure that they don't unfollow you. You want to make sure that they view you as a valuable resource, that they want to continue to get your messages every day. And then, of course, you're going to track and analyze impact. And I'm not going to talk about that because Anne's our expert in that, and she'll be talking about that in her segment of the webinar. So in the area of engagement, every seminar that I've been to, and eExtension has done a lot, they've always warned us not to really just be broadcasting. Broadcasting, of course, is just one way, you know, read our fact sheet, do this, that sort of thing. That's kind of old hat. People don't really want to be told what to do. People want to engage with you. So to the extent that you can ask questions, you know, got tax questions, looking for ideas for investing, where you kind of ask your followers if they, you know, kind of get them involved, just like you might do the same thing in a newspaper article to kind of hook your readers, you would do online with Twitter. Show interest in other people. Incorporate current events and seasonal events. And we certainly have a lot of that in personal finance with taxes and holiday spending and that sort of thing. Useful facts and links. People love that sort of thing. You know, if you can find something that's kind of unique, people will really value that information that they're getting from you. You can actually answer direct messages. You may get a direct message from one of your followers. And then another thing that is conventionally done on Fridays in the Twitter sphere, if you will, is people will acknowledge, do shout-outs or follow Fridays with their followers, or they'll recognize the people that have retweeted their messages during the previous week. So again, it's all about that engagement and that personalized contact that you can get with the people that are following you. And by the way, I didn't mention this, but whenever somebody does follow you, you do get an email message. So you're able to look at that email message and see who they are and then decide if you want to follow them as well. Here's an example on this slide of a retweet. So again, that's where you get a message in from somebody you think it's good, so you pass it along. And if you can see that top message, it says Rutgers SEBS, that's our School of Environmental and Biological Sciences. So that's our web person in our school, and she was retweeting a message about our horse, our equine specialist who got an award. And it actually came originally from Rutgers News. So it's basically two Twitter sites at Rutgers, one retweeting a message from another about a faculty member. So that's pretty much how retweeting is done. And these days, most people just do it by clicking a button. It says retweet right next to a message. So if you see a message and you like it, you can click on the retweet button. Another way you can do it is the older convention was RT and then a space and then that ampersand sign and the name of the person or the URL, the Twitter, the username, I guess, of the person. But most people do it with the buttons these days. And so that way you're just passing along useful information. You're getting it. You're saying, wow, this is good information. I want to pass it along to somebody else. So you retweet it. Some other Twitter tips that I've learned along the way, if you want to have your information come up on a search, you use a hashtag. So, for example, if you had a tweet about credit, you would do hashtag credit. And anybody who might be searching for tweets about credit, it would pull up in that search. So what we're going to be doing in the project that we're launching for America Saves Week is we're creating a unique hashtag for our project. It's going to be EXASW for E-Extension America Saves Week. And we'll be able to track all of the tweets that everybody does because we'll have this unique hashtag. People use this a lot at conferences. Anybody who went to AFCPE, there was like a parallel conference to AFCPE last fall. Anybody was doing a hashtag AFCPE and commenting on the speakers and the workshops and the food and everything else that you might comment on at a conference. If you have more than one word and you want to search on that that phrase rather than just one word, like credit cards, you would just put an underscore in between the two words so that they're all connected. And then credit cards get searched for. If you want to kind of shout out to another user, you would just use the at sign and then their username. And that way they kind of get flagged that you're kind of talking to them, if you will. You're trying to make them aware of your tweet. Another thing that you'll want to do is a URL shortener, because a lot of our website links pretty much take up almost 140 characters. So there are shorteners, bit.ly out, tiny URL, where they will make a very short web URL from a longer one, and then it frees up more characters. Another tip that I was taught was that if you can, try to keep your tweets to 120 characters. Even though you could go to 140, this just gives 20 extra characters for somebody to retweet you and still have enough, you know, characters to maybe say a word or two about the tweet. So it's just a good thing to think about. Try not to go up all the way to the 140 characters if you can. This is an example of bit.ly, what that URL shortener looks like. So you've got that big, long Rutgers NJES website. That was an article from our press room for Money 2000. Really long URL, probably, you know, 50, 60 characters, something like that. And what you would do is just put it in the box, click the button that says shorten, and then all of a sudden that really long URL goes into that really short bit.ly link. So what we have done for the America Saves Week project is we've taken some of the pages of America Saves Week, or America Saves, actually, their website, and also our eExtension personal finance website, the page on saving and investing, and we've taken those long URLs and shortened them with to bit.ly links. And then bit.ly not only gives you the opportunity to shorten your links, but you can also keep track of the clicks on your shortened links. And that's what we're going to be doing as part of our project to kind of track our outreach, is to take these shortened links that we've created for the America Saves web pages, and they're going to be kind of unique to our project because only people who are participating are really going to know. So that's going to be extension agents and some of the campaign coordinators for America Saves. And they'll be able to have that really short link. Another thing you may want to do is, if you get really involved in Twitter, is to use what they call applications or clients. There's different programs. Some people use TweetDeck. I use one called Hootsuite. And it's almost like a console or a deck where not only will you see your incoming tweets as you would Twitter.com, But you'll be able to see people who have mentioned you. You can see that in the slide there, that there's a mention column. So people who have retweeted you or mentioned you in their tweets, it makes it very easy for you to see that, as well as your direct messages. So in my Hootsuite application, I actually have 5 different columns that I can follow. And it's just a whole lot easier sometimes to use that than to just have all your incoming messages and have to scroll through them, especially if you're getting a lot of messages and you're following a lot of people. This is an example of another thing that we use in the COP called co-tweeting, where we actually have a number of COP members who are tweeting off of the same account, which we call Money Extension. Since obviously we're personal finance and we're e-extension, we kind of combine those two. And Michael will be talking more about that as it relates to Facebook too, but I just wanted you to be aware that we have a number of people from various land-grant universities who are providing messages, but they all come off this one account, which has branding for e-extension, and you know, it's kind of our account for our COP. And these are some examples of tweets that have come out of Money Extension, and we use that orange background with the green dollar sign because that was the logo that we chose for our fact sheets about our COP, so we just kind of want to keep the same branding throughout. And again, you can see that each of those tweets contains either a concept or in some cases a link to some other resource that's either at a university or in e-extension. And then just to kind of summarize here, this was an article that was about a year ago in Smart Money magazine, and it was talking about social media as it relates to investing. And at the time, there were about 8,000 messages that were coming through every day about investing. So, you know, it's not huge. I mean, I think there's still a lot of space for us as educators to get our messages out. And of course, the one thing that we have going for us, like we have had since Extension was formed in 1914, was that we've got that unbiased research-based information. We're not trying to sell anything. We're just trying to provide education. It's just a different way of doing it in 140 characters or less. So in conclusion, I would really recommend that everyone consider tweeting. And starting today, and in just a minute, we'll pop up the homework assignment. You can start small. You know, a lot of times people say, where am I possibly going to find the time? Well, you know, 10 or 15 minutes a day, and it doesn't even have to be all together. You can do 5 minutes in the morning, 5 minutes at lunch, 5 minutes in the afternoon before you leave work. Fit it in wherever you can. It's kind of like exercise. You got to find the time where you can. Start small, and you'll build your confidence, and you'll build your skills. We're hoping that as many of you as possible will want to participate in the social networking project that we'll be doing for America Saves Week. And if you're not on my list already, and my list has come from a couple of sources, people who signed up at AFCPE, people who completed the survey, and people who sent me emails after the last America Saves Week conference call. But if anybody still would like to participate, just send me an email. And it's O-N-E-I-L-L at ASOP, A-E-S as in Sam, O-N-P as in Peter, .rutgers.edu. And we'll get you on the list, and we'll be sending out tweets and Facebook messages already made up. The Facebook messages actually are done. They're just being proofread. We'll get them out next week, and all you have to do is insert them into your own social media, Twitter or Facebook, whatever you're using. And so you'll learn new information, because as you're getting tweets in, you're going to be getting, you know, cutting-edge research information, summaries of studies, all sorts of good information. And you'll learn a new skill, which, of course, will keep your skill set current, which is good. And you can have fun. You know, tweeting is not just for work. You can family, friends. I found my cousin after 27 years on Twitter last year. Lots of things could happen. So again, I encourage you to do that for professional improvement and also for another outreach method. At this time, if we have it available, Jeannie, if we could pop up that homework. assignments. It's in a PDF form. That would be wonderful. For those of you who are really serious, this was an idea that came up on our leadership team's call. Nancy Porter was saying, gee, I wonder if there's something that people can do to, you know, right after this webinar, if you're really hot to trot and you want to start using Twitter. So I've broken it down. I literally went back to Twitter as if I were a newbie and wrote it down step by step what you need to do. So you'll need to decide on your new username and maybe have a backup name or two just in case your username has already been chosen and you can't get it. It's kind of like license plates. And then you'll decide upon your password and write it down so you don't forget it, and your profile for your 160 characters. And then you can go on to Twitter, log in, and I've given you, I don't know if you can see it here, let me see if I can scroll down, I can. I've given you some possible places to start following. So you've got my website, you've got Michael Gutter, Rebecca Travnicek, so some of these people are extension people, Nisi, Jumpstart. I've given you all their Twitter addresses. And then the other thing you'll need to do once you have your own Twitter account is to publicize your address so people know that you're on Twitter and they can start to follow you, so put it in your newsletters and your email signature, everything like that. And then, of course, retweeting if you want to do that, and then just, again, making plans to set aside 15 to 20 minutes. So you've got your homework assignment. Those of you that want to go further with Twitter, I've given you all the steps that you need, and go forth and tweet. So I think I'll leave it there unless anybody has any questions, or maybe Michael can tell me if there's any questions.
Pause right now, we don't have any coming in, okay. But just a reminder, as you have questions, even if it's after our next presenter begins, please feel free to get them in the chat window. We'll definitely have time at the end as our goal. To revisit any questions we don't get to at any of the breaks. So certainly we do encourage you to do that. And also, if Barb, if they want this PDF version of it, can they email you or certainly email me to get a copy of that?
Yeah, and if there's a place we could post it, that would be great too. Is there a way we could post it like with the webinar on that on the
Absolutely.
Page?
Yep, okay. I will make sure that we get that done as well. And also, before we start our next presenter, if I could ask everybody, before you sign off today, we do ask, just in terms of evaluation, if it's possible, if you're willing to list your email address in the chat window or send it to me privately. This is just so we can follow up with a small evaluation of today's web conference. So if you do get a chance, please go ahead and put your email address either in the chat window or please go ahead and just send it to me in a private email so that we can follow up with you if you're willing to do that.
Before they move off of this real quick, I hate to interrupt, but they can save this document right now.
Oh, great.
Up in the upper right-hand corner, there's a pull-down. It's got little bars and a little arrow down. If you click on that, and there's a Save As, and that saves the PDF to your machine right now.
Oh, fantastic.
Super.
That was easy.
You're right. So.
Okay. Well, great. Well, certainly, and thank you so much, Barbara, for that conversation. I learned a little bit more. I've been tweeting for a little bit and still learned more today, so I appreciate that opportunity a great deal. At this time, seeing no additional questions, we will keep it moving. I'm going to turn it over to Michael Ravenscraft from the University of Missouri. Michael's going to share with us a little bit about using Facebook. So, Michael, your show, sir.
Thank you, Michael, and thank you, Barb. My name is Michael Ravenscraft, and I'm with the University of Missouri. And before we get started, I'd just like to say that a lot of the information that Barb presented is applicable to social media in general. So it's not necessarily specific to Twitter. A lot of the things that we'll talk about with using Facebook also are along those same lines. So having a mission statement and thinking about a personal versus a professional profile and how you set those things up are very similar, and I won't go into that again, but I just want to point that out, that those are important considerations. So getting started with Facebook, You go to the just go to facebook.com and create an account. And after your account is created, creating a profile is an important part of using Facebook. Facebook offers, in some ways, a more robust personal profile and more richer content sharing than Twitter, because as Twitter is designed to be a short 140 character message, Facebook allows for picture sharing and creating groups and more richer profiles and things that Twitter isn't designed to do. So some of this is overlap with Twitter, and we'll talk about how Facebook and Twitter can work together, but in some ways Facebook can be more personal. And that therefore adding a adding a rich profile is an important part of building that trust with the people that you connect with. So on Twitter they're followers, on Facebook they're friends, and creating the profile is an important first step. It also helps you connect in things that you have in common with other groups. So Facebook is good at connecting you with people, helping you connect with people that you may work with or be in the same geographic area or have similar interests. So the richer your profile, the better the chance that you will connect with the people that you have, that you would like to connect with. So after you've created your profile, you've added your employer and your networks, you can start connecting with people in your community, connecting with people, say, on campus, connecting with the field faculty, connecting with local partners or other national collaborators, connecting with thought leaders, as you might connect with Twitter. So I'm in a local county office, and you see this especially with 4-H now. The younger groups are almost entirely communicating via Facebook as opposed to via email. They will create, everyone's got a profile, they create groups and pages, and all the conversation happens over Facebook, where everybody is centrally located, and this is the primary method of communication. So the networking component comes in, although you may want to connect with local as well as statewide and national partners. Having this mission on how and why you want to be using Facebook helps you decide who to connect with and how you think those relationships might work. And this generally evolves as you use Facebook more after you get deeper into it. But in a local office, I know I'm connecting and maybe promoting local events, promoting a county event or a regional event or a statewide event. But you can also use it to publicize national events such as America Saves Week. So in some instances, it's more like a better way of communicating with individuals locally. And then there's also a way to communicate more like broadcasting as Twitter is designed to do. Creating events and holding discussions with other people is made a lot more efficient with Facebook than it is with things like email. So you can create events that let your friends on Facebook or the people that you connect with on Facebook know what events you're planning, where they're going to be, and then those events can easily be discussed on Facebook collaboratively or collectively with your group, as opposed to maybe sending reply all emails to everyone and filling up your inbox. Holding discussions is also easier, and there are multiple ways to do this. So you can send messages to individuals, almost like an email type service. You can post messages on the wall, which is kind of a just the web page within your profile. So you can send a message that is a public message that everyone can see if they look at the page. So if you were to post on my wall a message, everyone who went to my profile would be able to see that message. And then you can also create groups. So if you have a small group that's working on a project or a group that's collaborating on something, it's easier to communicate with that group And that would be a private conversation that was held through and inside Facebook. You can also post pictures, so if you have an event and you're publicizing past events or maybe the next annual event, you can post pictures to publicize those events. You can post status updates. The status update is in the image on the top of the screen, and it shows, it's almost like using Twitter. So if you post a status update, other people that you're friends with on Facebook will see that status update. So it's a short message that will that everyone will see and get that update that you sent out. So it's kind of like a public broadcast to all of your friends within Facebook. And in a minute, we'll talk about how that can be linked with Twitter. In this image of my Facebook profile, the status update from Money eExtension, which is the Twitter account, is actually automatically posted to my Facebook page because it's linked with Twitter. But I could just as easily type in that box and share that message with all of my Facebook friends. And then there's the personal versus professional debate, and then which information you'd like to keep public or keep private versus make public. If you only have one profile and there are things you'd like to keep private, the Facebook privacy settings are becoming increasingly capable of filtering information between groups of people, but they're also becoming increasingly complex. You can share with everyone, with friends of friends or friends only, and then there are custom settings that you can really cater very specifically by each type of information, who you want to see it, even down to the individual. So you could look through all your friends and say, I don't want this person to see this information. If there's a lot you want to keep separate, it might be wise to create a separate account, but the privacy settings can be used to help you manage that information. And then creating pages is another, is creating a page is like creating a profile for something other than a person. This is often used by entities, or so you can create a page for your office or for your university, for an event, or for maybe your discipline in your state. This is an image of the page for Money eExtension, which is the eExtension Facebook page. And then people can choose to like this page, which is like being a friend of the page. The status updates posted on this page the messages listed on this page are the status updates, which are actually shared between Facebook and Twitter. So every time something is written on this page, the Facebook account is updated as well as the Twitter account, and these messages are shared with those people who have connected with this page. And then connecting with Twitter. So if you are using Facebook and Twitter, you can link the two accounts so that any status update or any message that you send to all your Facebook friends will also be tweeted to your Twitter followers. And then vice versa, any message that is tweeted will also display on your Facebook page and come across as a status update so that your Facebook friends see that same update. So one of the issues with using social media and using these different types of social media is that, as Barb pointed out, you need to stay relevant and stay engaged in the conversation, but there are so many social media outlets that it can consume all of your time. So linking the two pages can be a way to make things more efficient and keep you from having to check multiple accounts and post to different groups of people using different technologies. And that's my last slide. If there are any questions, I'd be happy to address them.
Well, and actually, but thank you so much, Michael. And again, if people have questions, we had a few questions come up that are both relevant for Barb and Michael. And if we could, we'll just take some of those now, if that's all right with you, Michael.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The first was a question that comes to us from Mike Lambert. And this was a simple question about what about using extension as just a means to have conversations with your clientele? So any thoughts on that? And Barb, that's probably more to you, I imagine.
Well, if people are doing that, I mean, there's something that I learned at the Extension Conference a few years ago called Tweet Ups, where people will actually have their followers and then meet with them face-to-face at some point. And we actually put that in the grant for America Saves Week because we figured a lot of people might be having a program during that week anyway, so they can have what they call a tweet up, where they can actually tweet about America Saves or saving and then actually hold a program or an informal gathering. So it's possible, you know.
I see it in, you know, with communities, if I've got people that connect via Facebook, they've come to an event, they have a question, they send me a Facebook message, and you send back. Use it almost just like an email service. It's easy to find me because they just need to know my name, and they go to Facebook, they search, and they send me a message. And it's a very easy way to facilitate a conversation that might not otherwise happen.
Yeah, and again, if you could use hashtags, you know, because if you can create a unique hashtag and only people in the know in your group would know that, it's a good way for people to get messages quickly just by following the hashtag.
Excellent. And I know there's been other examples of that, too. And the media here in Florida, for example, one of the interesting things was simply that our new governor took to having Twitter rather than interacting in some of the public forums that others use, and mainly because he felt it was a way to have simple, brief dialogues with people in many meaningful ways. So I think that this does continue to grow, and I think those are really great points. A few additional questions, and we have some more coming in, so I want to get to these quickly. A neat question here, which just said, quoted the info from the financial FSA COP members. If I got the question correctly, financial small community of practice, one of the e-extension communities of practice. Slides can be available. I believe everyone's willing to share their slides. It looks like we're having some problems downloading these. That button wasn't working for many of you. So if you've sent your email address, we should be able to post these slides, assuming all our presenters agree. We can post those as well with the additional information at the webinar address. And we're at the same link where the bios were is where eventually the webinar will be archived. A few more questions. Barb, again, another one on tweeting. Does tweeting need to happen every day, or can a following be maintained if you only tweet once a week?
You can tweet as often as you want, but I think you'll get a little bit more engagement if you do it more frequently. You'll also get a higher score on some of the evaluation metrics that Anne will be talking about, because they look at frequency of tweets as one of the factors that goes into it. One thing I would recommend, though, is if you're going to tweet, don't do it all at one time. I personally have unfollowed some groups and people that just like send out 20 tweets in a row. I mean, it's just overkill, you know, if you have that many tweets and it's just boom, 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 boom. So what we're encouraging people to do with this America Saves social media project is we're going to provide you with 70 tweets to space out over the course of the 8 days of America Saves Week. And then we're encouraging you to space them out. So maybe do two or three in the morning, two or three maybe at lunchtime, early afternoon, late afternoon, something like that, just so when people pop up their inbox, they're not going to see, 10 tweets from you all at once, and they'll be getting the savings message throughout the entire day. So I would keep that in mind.
Excellent. And then just a few more final thoughts, and then we'll move on to Anne. Any pros and cons, and I think this is good for both of you here, and Anne too. What are the pros and cons of using your personal name versus a topic name? So, for example, you know, as Barb mentioned, at Money Extension versus at Mike Gutter. Barb, any thoughts? And Michael, certainly, in terms of for Facebook as well.
Well, I don't know, maybe a little bit of marketing because my username says money, you know, so right there off the top, somebody knows it has something to do with personal finance. And obviously, like I said before, they could always just click on the profile and realize the person behind the name. Maybe perhaps a little bit on privacy, too, because unless they do that, they're not going to know it's me, so it's just one little layer of privacy, perhaps. I don't know.
On Facebook, I think generally you create a profile using your personal name, but then you can create pages that are that have a different name. And one of the advantages to, or the differences, with a personal name, people think they're connecting with you personally. With the page, they're connecting with an entity that may be bigger than one person. As Barb mentioned with CoTweet, there were multiple people behind that Twitter name that were sending messages through that account. So an advantage to that can be that the account could potentially have an undefined life span. So if someone were to leave an institution or to quit tweeting, others could pick up the slack and share the responsibility. And that's an advantage of using CoTweet or a similar technology as well as a Facebook page that's not associated with an individual, but is instead associated with a collaborative team or an entity that's using that page.
Excellent. Thank you so much, both of you, for that response. Also, one more additional comment, and this is just a great comment from Nancy Porter. General, before you begin engaging in any of these, you should be sure if your institution has any sort of policy in place on the use of social media. It's possible that there may be regulations in place from what you're allowed to do in terms of Twitter, Facebook, accessing those, so on and so forth. Finally, one logistics question. If you did not get the link to the bios, if you put your name in the email address, I will be sending out an email to let everyone know when this is available as an archive. So if you've already posted your email address, you'll get that link once again, which is where we'll also post all of the materials that have been discussed today for those of you whose links were not working. So again, just hopefully make sure that's available for everyone. That in mind, and in the interest of time, I do want to get us back on track as much as possible. And again, hopefully at the end, we'll have time for additional questions. So I believe it's now time to hear from our final presenter. Anne, it's all up to you right now. Anne is going to talk to us now that we've heard about these two major ways in which we can engage in social media and social marketing. We can learn a little bit more about the impact evaluation that goes with our efforts. So Anne, if you're ready, I'd love to turn it over to you.
Okay, great. I had to laugh when I think it was Barbara said I was the expert in evaluation for social media, and I don't know that anybody can be an expert because it's so changing so fast, and so many different tools are out there, and it's just really kind of hard to stay up to date and be an expert, but we continue to learn. And so that's kind of what I'm going to be talking about. The slide's not coming up on my screen. Does anyone else see it?
Yeah, this is Barb. I see it fine.
Okay.
Yeah, I see it as well, Anne.
Okay, I don't see it at all, which is going to make presenting kind of interesting. What I'm going to do is I'm going to log out of the conference and come back and try to talk at the same time. this week we also had a professional development session with the ACE, which is the Communicators for Extension and Agriculture Association, and it was a joint session with the IT SIG and the marketing SIG. And we had asked a few people to present, and one of them was Mike Lambert, who's on the web conference today. And another one was Dan Tolan with Farm Bureau, Ohio Farm Bureau. And the another one was Eli Sager, who's an extension specialist in Minnesota for forestry. But anyway, it was kind of interesting in that, let me see, I'm trying to get loaded up here, in that they all kind of said we just can't look at evaluation as just a numbers thing, and certainly there won't be something that will measure everything we want to measure. It did load this time. Whew. Okay, so now I'm ready to get started. real quick, the slide share, this presentation is available and online, and you can use it, download it, use it in any way you want to, as long as you just give attribution back to that web link. So that's available, and if I forget to tell you, you can contact me by phone, email, Facebook, Twitter, any way you want to. And a lot of this session that I'll be showing today came from Mike Lambert's a report that he did, and then he also participated in that web conference the other day. The other thing that was mentioned in that web conference is Dan Tolan, who is with Ohio Farm Bureau, and he's done a few things for Extension for us. He commented afterwards, and he said, you know, it was fun because he got to talk about impact and evaluation of social media, and all he's done up to this point is telling people how and why to use social media. So I think that shows that social media is maturing some, that we're not just talking about it just getting started or why we should use it or how we should use it, but now looking at its effect. Michael, this I have to contribute this thought to Mike Lambert. Really, social media is a means to an end, and the means really about conversations and interactions. So that's a little different for some of us, because in some of the things that we do in Extension, we tend to broadcast, and Barb brought that up earlier. But it's now a way to have conversations and interactions online. And I often compare social media online to having conversations with clientele locally. Here I live in a fairly small university town. There is the Kroger that's in the center of town, and when you go there, it's been there forever, and when you go there, you always see people from town. So I go there and I see moms and dads of my kids' parents, and I haven't seen them in several years because our kids aren't involved in the same activities, so we stop and we talk, and it's those kind of conversations that we can now have online. They're kind of quick. They can be in depth if you use other means to do that. But, you know, and I imagine a county agent, a local agent, stopping in their local grocery store and running into people, and they have conversations. And, you know, it's about kids and all that, but then again, that person may go, well, you know, I hear you putting on a program on a credit card debt or something. And so, and then you don't stop right then and say, oh, I am in my individual social time and I'm not answering any Extension questions. And so now we can do that kind of thing online. We can mix them, and that does cause some confusion and has us scratch our heads with what ifs and that kind of thing. The end, though, is connecting individuals with Extension resources. And I see Extension resources not only those things like the COP page that has so many great resources there, information, that kind of thing, but I also see resources as our Extension people themselves. You know, we often talk about Extension's greatest asset is our people. Totally agree with that, and this is one way to connect with the people online as the people, as one of our resources. The other thing that was brought up in that session we had the other day is social media is not just about the numbers. We're going to talk. I'm going to show you how you can get some numbers and why they're important from a relative standpoint, and it helps you kind of keep gaining ground. But it's not about numbers. It's about kind of the perception that people have of our materials, of our resources, and our credibility. And it is at times about engagement and emotions. And Mark Light is on this web conference, and he works within 4-H, and certainly the emotions and getting kids excited about things certainly is somehow we've got to tap into that, but then somehow we have to tap into when people get emotional about their financial situation, how we can address that and help people in changing behavior for the good. Before you get started in talking about impact, you have to know who your audience is. And this sounds like a kind of a strange thing to talk about right now. I like to call them a community, because when you start getting involved in social media, think of social first, and then you're becoming one of many. And so it's not you necessarily always talking to a group or one to many. And you can be, if you can look at it, depending on your goals, you can look at it as audience, or you can look at it as your community. And how you look at this defines some of your goals, and then will define how you go about evaluating. And before we get started, and I really like the idea that Barb gave you in what is your mission statement for creating a Twitter account, because that kind of shows what you are after. And so if your goal is about teaching others and providing content, that goal is maybe different than the goal of engaging people or the goal of becoming a credible source. Not the thing is you can have several goals. You don't have to have just one. But before you get started on your impact or trying to evaluate, you really kind of need to know where you want to go. And so for companies, and I've talked with several marketing companies or people who sell products within a particular niche, and their goal is to sell more products. Well, how do they do that? One of those ways is to increase visits to their website. A marketing firm, that would be an important thing. But along with that, there are keys that make that effective and not so effective. And whether that is going to change behavior or sell your product is another thing. And so as extension people, are we trying to change behavior? If we are, then broadcasting only probably won't quite get you there. So engagement has to happen. I threw up the list before and on this slide too as some goals to think about beyond just providing information. And one of the things that I see as a great possibility for extension and university faculty in general is that to strengthen your own reputation with as a professional on in the social environment that's on the web. And so how do you do that? And part of that is providing those research-based information, always being on your top game, but also acting like a professional in all aspects. And then also being a person. Because when people identify with people more when they see them as kind of a real person. So, you know, the nice thing about some of this online things now is that you can let go a little bit and be a little more engaging in kind of a personal way. Beth Cantor is a nonprofit social media guru. And if you want to look her up and look up some of her materials and what she talks about, this is a great opportunity. If you know local nonprofits that are trying to get into social media, this would be somebody I would direct them to look at some ways to go about it. But she talks about the social media strategy and how it moves through time and how it moves based off of the tools you choose and how you choose to use them. And the first step is to listen. And so you can listen right now with a Twitter account or without a Twitter account, just go in and start doing some searching. You can listen by doing some Google searching and that kind of thing. The other thing is engagement and then providing some kind of social content, and we'll talk about these as well. Also, you want other people to talk about you in a good way, or talk about your materials. So you can really kind of scale your work if you can convince people you know what you're talking about, and then they start retweeting you, or better yet, they start putting your stuff within their own media packages. For instance, there's a newspaper kind of thing that they do with Twitter and blogs, and there are a couple of people who will take, they take tweets in a given day or a given week and create this little newspaper, and so I get notified when one of my tweets show up there. Last night I tweeted about the professional development piece that we, the learnextension.org, and that got put on a newspaper that is not done by somebody in extension. And so, you know, it's kind of neat to see what people pick up and are willing to share. Again, this slide is something that Mike came up with as he did some research. And if we look at different kinds of engagement online, you've got the site visits, that kind of thing. We know about that. We know that people can talk about blogs, or they can either contribute to blogs or comment on them. They can upload and create things like YouTube, that kind of thing. But then we also have the feelings and perceptions and consumer attitudes. And as we think about maybe changing behavior or getting people to think about saving and that kind of thing, these are the things that we want to be looking at. And then we want to see if we are influential and getting people to take our advice and spread it. Another idea is to look at engagement from whether the engagement is a positive or a negative. And once it is one side or the other, then the degree as to which side is it. Like if it's positive, how positive are people towards extension materials that they find on the web? How positive are they to the extension professionals that they meet online? And so how do we go about doing this? And one is to look at the interaction and involvement, and this is by using data, and those are the easiest things, so you'll see some slides and examples on those, how to do that. And the other is to look at qualitative. And, you know, this is a hard one to get, but I, for me, in watching over the last 2 or 3 years, what I find is when I get emails saying, I used your stuff, or I did this, or I now have a Twitter account, or now a blog. I started blogging 6 months ago because of something that you did at a conference or whatever. And so those kinds of things is what I hear that sometimes mean a lot more than the numbers. So when we're looking at numbers, Google Analytics, if you're familiar with using that e-extension, you can do that on your COP page as well as Facebook page. And so it's a Google free product. If you're not already using Google Analytics on whatever web page, this is one way to do that. Then the other thing is start counting Twitter followings and followers. And I would think that as Barb has moved through time on her Twitter account, her number of followers is going up. And so can I have an idea about to what degree they're going up? There's also an idea about how relevant those followers are, and we may get into that in a little bit. But so in looking at interactions, what do people say, and how many fans you have, what are they posting on your Facebook page? If they're not posting at all, then it's probably more of a broadcast thing. If they're commenting, is there interaction? And so, again, you want to count the number of fans, but you may even start counting the number of comments and that kind of thing. And YouTube as well, they have ratings. Those things are, again, something that you can do from a count standpoint. This is the one that's hard to get at, but it is so important, because as people try to as people are listening to you, seeing what you do online, and then if they are commenting in a positive or negative way or having questions, as you see how those questions evolve over time, that will give you an idea about how you are moving through being effective. And for me, I've been watching lots of different extension people get online on Twitter and Facebook, and to watch them grow is to me an evaluation and impact thing that I see that is a positive. And so again, if you can start watching people that have been tweeting financial stuff, or they start tweeting your stuff, and then as they mature in the things they find and share and talk about, that is a qualitative thing to be looking at. But you can also do things in asking them questions, because if you've built up a engagement and credibility with them, then you can go back and ask them questions and survey them. You can do polls and that kind of thing. You can do that on Twitter. You can do that on your web page and in Facebook. It's funny, I have a lot more options for monitoring Twitter, and I'm going to go through each one of these. So I'm just going to skip over this slide. Clout, I think somebody has already mentioned Clout. It is a score that this company gives you, and it indicates not only the number, it really is an indicator of how you are engaging and how things are retweeted and how often you are replied to. If you tweet too much, they actually penalize you. And what that too much is, I don't know. But if you, my thinking is, if you tweet a lot and you don't have many retweets and replies in relation to the amount that you tweet, then that score may go down as well. And it looks at how big your network is and that kind of thing. And we're going to look at some other scores. Not one of these tools is going to evaluate your use of social media. To me, you have to use lots of different tools, think about them in relative terms, and how they measure or meet up to some of your goals that you have. Twitterlizer, this is one that I haven't actually used a lot, but there's some things in here that I really kind of like to see and just kind of watch over time. The effective reach, if my effective reach is 6,000 people, wow. If the potential reach is 40,000, even another wow. But what's kind of nice about this, too, is it kind of gives you an idea about where you are in reference to other people. Some of the numbers that are used in the Tweet Analyzer are coming from Peer Index. Basically, these were two different programs, and they kind of now merging a little bit together. I watch how these scores change over time. The audience score, and it's up to 100, but if you get to a score of 40, because it's normalized, you're in the top 10% of people in Twitter, your activity and that kind of thing. So some of that is, some of these things we really need to consider where you are within the community of interest. So some of these scores are based off of Twitter as a whole, but it doesn't really matter how you are as a whole if you're not effective within your niche. And so these, again, are some things that we have to watch and have to put them in relative terms. Tweet Effect, this is a one that I haven't, I don't know if I can't remember Mike or someone else posted it, but it is one that kind of that tells you when I'm losing followers and when I'm gaining them. I just based off of my own behavior of following and unfollowing people, most of the time I don't unfollow people because of their tweets. It's usually because of something else, or because of one tweet. It's usually because of some other thing, as Barb mentioned earlier, tweeting too much and that kind of thing. TweetReach, this is one that I would highly encourage you to learn a little bit more about, and particularly it can be used with a hashtag for the America Saves Week. The other day we did this web conference and we used the Extension Professional Development hashtag. There were 48 tweets that came out of that and it reached over 8,000 people. So the way it created that number is it took the number of followers that each one of us has and subtracted the duplicates, and then whether those 8,300 people actually read the tweets, we don't know, but all those people got tweets from this hashtag. And then when you start multiplying those, and like I tweeted several times and in the conference, and then they count people more than once, because if let me see if Beth Rainey has some of the same followers I have, when they're counted more than once, then you get the number of impressions. I kind of ignore the impressions because I don't think it gives you a lot of information, although impressions would be something that marketing people, advertising people, take a lot of stock in. So those were the things that I use for Twitter. Again, I would much rather see that somebody has used my material in Twitter, retweeted me, commented back, than to worry so much about those numbers. But anyway, that's the way I look at it. Bit.ly, this is something that Barb had talked about earlier. It's a shortening program, and you can go in and check out how many people actually clicked on those links. And so we can see how often they clicked on your link in relation to others. I'm trying to see the iPhone. I have on the screen capture iPhone apps for agriculture was actually a blog post by an LSU extension entomologist. And I posted it, and 31 out of the 83 people who clicked on the link in Twitter came from where I posted it. So that I thought that was pretty good that we had more than a quarter of the ones come from mine. And it was also nice to see just in that little bit of time that people hit it 83 times. One thing to remember is that people, the rule of thumb is if you're going to get a reaction out of a tweet, you're going to get it within the first hour that you tweeted it. So when you tweet things makes a difference. 8 o'clock in the morning is one of the best times to tweet. Sundays are not so good, so you need to consider those things. I have been known to tweet something on the weekend and then rewrite the tweet in some way on Monday, and I'll get a lot more response from it. Monitoring Facebook, again, you can use Google Analytics. Facebook has its own analytic page to it. It gives you an email every week as when you're an administrator of a page, how often people like your page, commented, and that kind of thing. And then we want to look at the links followed from that Facebook page, and again, look at the comments. I was in a ag chat thing last night on Twitter. I don't always do that, but I've been following this lady who has a cattle farm, and she created a Facebook page, and I had never looked at it. But then when I went to it yesterday just to see kind of what she's doing, it was pretty amazing the comments and questions that she's getting from people who don't really know anything about farming or raising cattle. And she definitely was doing the engaging thing, answering questions, and being a real advocate for agriculture. So it's those kinds of things that we're looking for in the extension as well. And again, discussion changes. You hope that within a group, a specific following group, that some of this stuff kind of matures. And I say that, but then you're going to create some new followers who, you know, would be wanting some basic things. So you kind of have to gauge those that are maturing with the information and those that are continue to be new. Here's an example of a Facebook page where it's showing the use of it. And what's kind of nice about it is it breaks it down in some demographics that can be useful. And then again, here's another look at monitoring your Facebook pages. We didn't talk about YouTube, but it also has analytics to it, and kind of interesting. That would be one that comments really could become something that's really interesting. I think from this Horse Quest page, there's a good bit of engagement and learning that's going on in the comments, and that's kind of what we would be after. But we're also a little scared of some of the comments, so we have to monitor those. And if nothing else today, you don't have a Twitter account, you may not even have a Facebook account, or maybe you don't have a Facebook page. If you don't do anything else, create some kind of Google alert on either a term that you want to keep up with, or on your own name, or on the name of your community of practice, or maybe America Saves. This Google alert would work a lot better if I put financial security for all in quotes, because now I'm getting all kinds of email alerts back that are all over the board, which is kind of nice because I can learn from that. But if I'm interested in seeing financial security for all being used as a term, I would want to put that in quotes. So you can go ahead and do some impact and evaluation on how these things are being used right now. And it does pick up, in some cases, things from Twitter, depending on how the people with a Twitter account has their set up. My Twitter account is showing up in with a Google index. So I kind of challenge you, though, if we looked at the 320 members of the Financial Security for All COP, and each one of them spent 15 minutes a day in some kind of online activity, we look at the number of hours that would be, and then we look at the impact that that could have, and say those 320 people then had were followed by 50 people who cared about the topic. And that's key, because I think being relevant within your topic is extremely important. And those 50 people could be, they could be consumers, but they also could be people who are considered to be authority within this area of work. They could be news people who write about financial security. So, but anyway, if the 320 of you all were followed by 50 people, which is really not that many, that would be 16,000 people if each one of those were unique. Boy, you could really make an impact, and that's something that we could really think about. You know, I've talked about this a little bit, but the balancing scale, broadcasting the numbers with being effective in the area that you want to be effective is a real challenge. And so sometimes you kind of have to choose which way you're going to go, and that should be based off of your goals. And this is my last slide. As I think about having impact and making a difference to our audience or to our community, what's really neat about the social media is it also can have an impact on your own learning. So where you can learn from other people, solve problems that maybe you're wrestling with the community of practice, and even help others perform better, maybe help ourselves perform better. So these are just some ideas, and again, this can be something to think about from a goal perspective, that it's not always about a goal for the audience, but it's a goal for our own learning. There are references in this SlideShare. Again, it's on slideshare.net under my username, and somebody mentioned that earlier. Do you keep the same username? And I pretty much do. I also going to give photo credits for each of the photos I use. And finally, I'll take any questions and comments. And you are welcome. Please, please, please call me, email me, look me up, Google me, you'll find my number. And I'll answer any questions or help and clarify, because this went kind of quickly, on any of the evaluation tools.
Well, thank you so much, Anne, first of all, for that. At this time, certainly if you have any questions, now is a great time. I also want to ask if we could get our polls that are posted, if we could just possibly get those listed somewhere on the screen that's not too obstructive. We had three polls that are available, and we do ask that you just spend a few moments before you, as you're thinking of questions to ask, just make sure you respond to the poll, please. There'll be three questions that come up. So that's certainly very important there. And also a reminder, if you did not put your email address in the chat window, I know most of you did, it looks like. If you didn't, please do take a chance to do so. We would love to make sure that we're able to follow up with you and see if you were able to use any of this information in your extension efforts. So again, please take the time to do that. Lastly, well, we do have some questions. So again, if the polls disappeared, so if we can get those back up, that'd be great. Should hopefully be up here in just a second. I know they disappeared. And in the meantime, Jorge had a question, where do Google Alerts come from? And I would say the Stork, but I'm sure there's a better answer for that. So if we could turn that over maybe to our presenters, if any of you are familiar with how Google Alerts originated.
Google Alerts are based off of how Google indexes the things on the web. So I have a Google Alert on my name, as well as several other things, and I have them come to me once a day. So when someone uses my name and it gets indexed in Google, it sends me an alert. So it's possible to have something on the web, but it not be indexed in Google. I hope that helps. If not, I'll try again.
Well, that certainly helped me. Hopefully that answers that question. Additional questions. I see lots of people typing, so bear with us here as those are coming up. And thank you, Elaine Courtney. Any, while people may be trying to work out some last questions, I don't know if any of our presenters had anything else that they wanted to address or if they wanted to highlight or come back and revisit any of the things that they were discussing earlier, but certainly we have a few moments left while people are responding to polls, if any of you had any final thoughts.
Oh, okay. I see, Barb, which evaluation tool do I like the most? You know, the one I've been using the most is clout.com because it gives me this relative figure that incorporates engagement as well as, I'll say engagement, the replies and retweets and that kind of thing. There's some downsides to that, but they are improving. So some of the things I didn't like, they're fixing. But the peer index one, I found it in the last week or two and I've heard about it, but I really kind of looked into it more. And I like it now because it gives me a little more detail. You know, it gives me the retweets, but in retweets in a percentage. And so as some of those numbers go down, I might need to be looking at who I'm engaging with or what I'm tweeting about. My problem is that I tweet about a lot of different things. I mean, ag industry is always going to be kind of a passion of mine, but then we have military families, and then I do social media, and I've got marketing and advertising, and so they're just, it's very broad, so it's kind of hard to judge on my followers what really works for them. And so hopefully, as you have a smaller niche, maybe that would be easier. Bitly gives me the kinds of things I need from a click-through. That's really quite nice as well.
Thank you very much for that. I had a question. The polls, there should be buttons to click on. I think most of you are having some luck with that, but do keep trying. It should be open for you to still enter in information. I see the numbers changing periodically. A few other additional questions here. I think this is for you, Ann. Does Hootsuite give you click data to links if you use their tool for shortening URLs?
Kathy, thanks for following me. It does give some basic information on links, and I think Dan Tolan talked about that on Monday. I don't use Hootsuite. It didn't really give me what I was looking for early on, and it's improved and that kind of thing. I don't think it works that the short URL it uses is different than Bitly, and so there's some basic analytical stuff that Hootsuite will give you that Tweet doesn't, and it does give some on links, but I don't know that it plays well with Bitly, and I need to check on that for sure. If that's still a bothering question in a day or so, send me an email and I'll investigate that more.
Excellent. I see a few more questions coming in. We are almost out of time, and again, I thank everybody who's been attending. If you've been answering the poll questions, I want to thank you also for providing us with this very valuable feedback. Of course, we'll continue to take questions right up until the end, but in case you're popping out, I did just want to say, on behalf of the Financial Security for All community of practice, we're very excited that all of you were able to join us. I hope that many of you will accept the call to action, especially during America Saves Week, and hopefully join Barb and others in tweeting, Facebooking, and everything else that we've now turned into a verb. So that we do hope that you all continue to participate with that again. Charles asked, could we list the name of the service that Barbara uses again?
Well, I use Hootsuite, the one that we just mentioned.
Okay. So, Charles, hopefully that's the one you were talking about. There was Hootsuite, and I see Ann was able to type that in for us. If it was the other one that her and Andrew were using, there's also Bitly was the other one that they may have mentioned as well that was used for shortening hyperlinks.
Right, Bitly.
Great. Well, thank you guys all so much for coming. It's exactly 2:30 on the money, so I will officially pull this to a close. If there's additional questions, I do hope you'll all continue to ask and email, follow along. Some of the people we mentioned before that have Twitter feeds or are putting up information on this on Facebook, so feel free to kind of join in, if you will, in this new venture that many of us are working on. So thank you all so much for participating. I hope you'll be able to complete the follow-up evaluation when you receive that in email shortly. And again, thank you guys so much. Have a wonderful week.